If you've ever wondered what really happens when the fastest men in college all get together on one track, you should have been paying attention to the Tom Jones Memorial Meet this past weekend, because that is exactly what they were doing at the University of Florida. We know that the Florida Gators are the defending national champions, and they've won 6 of the last 11 championships. But they normally do it with the sprinting events. So when they host the meet, they're already bringing some of the best sprinters there anyway. So everyone else sends theirs as well. And for where we are in the collegiate season, we kinda already know who the fastest guys are. Most of them already proved it indoors. But outdoors, we've seen some fast performances from athletes who we didn't really notice. Jordan Ware is one of them when he put out the collegiate lead in the 200. That was then, this is now. But I'm also gonna give you another name, Saminu Abdul-Rashid. In the 100, he was in NAIA a while ago, but that was then, like I said, this is now. And at this time, he runs for South Florida and has broke the 10-second barrier to become the collegiate leader. But yes, it was a wind-assisted time. So the Tom Jones Memorial Meet was an opportunity to watch all of those types of guys get on the track. As far as I'm concerned, this was the closest thing we were gonna get to a pre-national meet. You can argue with me if you think it's the Texas relays. You can even tell me you thought it was the Florida relays a few weeks before. But look at the starting list. In the 200, Tarsis Orogot, who was a world championship semifinalist last year, broke 20 seconds going 19.90. He won the event with Chetna Treyor right behind him. Chetna Treyor of Penn State, formerly a D3 runner, was second at the D1 meet indoor this past season. He is incredibly legit, and Jordan Ware was right there. He was third. I tried to tell you that freshman, Jordan Ware, is a legitimate threat. I don't know if he's gonna do it at the SECs, and I don't know if he's gonna do it at the NCAAs, but he has the talent to do it, and now he is proving it. And I know you want me to talk about the 100 meter dash, and trust me, I'm getting to that. But if you're new here, I have to say thank you for even making it this far into the video. And I'm Coach Rob, the founder of SBARecruiting.com, where I rank the best high school track and field recruits in the entire nation. And if anything that I say actually connects with you, it is always greatly appreciated if you would please like and subscribe. But if I don't, just let me know in the comments section, because I try to read them all. But I'm gonna address the 4x1s, because it was the first event that I saw on the track, because I was there in person to watch most of this go down. If you've been paying attention to the leaderboards, it shouldn't be a surprise that Auburn won the 4x1 in 38.64 seconds. That lowers their collegiate lead. But to clarify, when I saw them run, seemed to me like they've got more speed in them, which does make sense if you actually see who's on that relay. LSU and Kentucky did finish relatively close behind them, but that is not really what I was focused on. I saw Texas Tech at the meet, but they weren't running with their fastest guys. Terrence Jones, DeAndre Swint, these guys weren't on the starting list. So whatever 4x1 they put out there, which is still really fast, is nowhere near as fast as it will be when you add both of them and Caleb Dean onto the track. So, Texas Tech is still my sleeper pick at the NCAAs, because I haven't seen any evidence yet. Not that Auburn isn't fast, but that they're fast enough to beat those guys if they get to stick around properly. I've gotta be honest with you, my head is actually spinning from the weekend, because so much talent was on the track at the same time. It was ridiculous. Christopher Morales-Williams faced off with Ahmad Robinson in the 400. The same thing that they did a few weeks ago at the NCAA Indoor Championship meet, where they went 1-2. It's the same thing that happened again. Christopher Morales-Williams won the meet. He broke 45 seconds to do it. And remember, I was there live, just a few feet away, sitting in the front row while they run past me on the home stretch. The way Christopher Morales-Williams gutted it out to win this performance, that is what's standing out in my mind. The NCAA meet's gonna come and go. He should win that meet, but maybe he won't. Ahmad Robinson has a good claim, and there's other guys who are in that meet who are incredibly fast. Judson Lincoln, shout out to you. But that is not what I'm talking about at the moment. Christopher Morales-Williams will be at the Olympics representing Canada, barring something unforeseen. The only real question is if anybody else, whether they're American or not, can beat him when they get to that event. From what I've seen so far, and now what I've seen with my own eyes, I would have to say it might have been an underachieving race for him, which is scary, because he might have the talent to break 44. And to cap it all off, they did run Olympic development sections of the 400 at the meet. There were some heavy hitters on the track to race, including the American champion from last year. Nobody broke 45, except Ahmad Robinson, who's going to be a problem at the Olympic trials now, and Christopher Morales-Williams. So when I try to tell you that college track is basically professional level, I'm really not making this up. You can watch them back to back and it look about the same. But yes, I'm now going to address the 100 meter dash situation, because like I said, minus Terrence Jones, it was a stacked field. I'm rattling this part off from memory, but these are some of the names who are on the starting list. I already told you about Jordan Ware, and he was third in the 200. He came back in the 100, but he is not the most talented freshman in the nation, at least in my opinion. That would be Nick Harbor, who also lined up for the 100. In addition, you had Saminu Abdul-Rashid, who I tried to tell you about earlier. He was the fastest man on the leaderboards heading into this meet. Remember, we're not caring about the wind gauges right now. Godson Ogunbrume was also there for LSU. And Sean Mathwangani of Houston. Remember, some of these athletes, like Sean Mathwangani, have world championship level experience and still came back to college. This is an Olympic year, and they're preparing for it with these races. The only way I can make it clear how much talent was on the track is if I tell you that Kalen Walker ran the 100 and was not even in the first heat. He was second at the NCAA indoor meet in the 60 meter dash. And he was the collegiate leader for multiple weeks in the 100. He ran 10.09 to pull it off. That is how much heat hit the track. I don't really know how to say this without it coming out harsh, but I sincerely apologize to anybody who wasn't in the first three heats, because we really weren't paying attention to you that much once we got that far into the meet. When you put that many fast people on the track, somebody actually has to look slow. And on top of that, if you choose to run the heats from fast to slow, when somebody runs 10.4, we're really not paying attention anymore. Favor Ashe of Auburn didn't come back to run in this race. If he did, we'd basically be looking at a pre-national final with just about all the heavy hitters. Remember, Terrence Jones wouldn't be on that list. But when the dust settled, Sean Mathwangani got the victory in 10.12 seconds with basically no wind. And I also have to say this because I was a collegiate sprinter. This was finals on time. It's not like they had a prelim to get ready for it. So as a result, the times they're putting down are not going to be quite as fast if they had more rounds prior to it. After sitting there live on the finish line and watching 10 heats of these hundreds go off with a bunch of fast guys from start to finish, let us be clear. You need to actually run the races. I know we get very excited about who runs the fast time in this meet or that meet, but none of that really matters because this is a competitive sport. You have to line up with somebody and actually take them out. That's why this meet was so entertaining, because the fast guys had to line up with each other. It didn't matter what heat you were in anymore. You just had to put it down. As far as the sprints go, unless you run in the SEC, you're probably not gonna see a meet this competitive ever again until the NCAA regional meet. That is just me being honest with you. I've said it before and I'll say it again. In a track meet like this, no matter how fast you actually are, somebody's gonna have to look slow. Most of the athletes on the track were four-star recruits on SCARecruiting.com, probably by the end of their junior year. It's really the only way you get recruited to a program in the Big Ten or the SEC or anything like that, unless you're like Kalen Walker and you climb your way out of junior college. Oh yeah, transfer portal, that's a thing now. What I'm trying to get at is be careful what you wish for. If you are a high school recruit, because the Tom Jones Memorial is the type of meet where only the strong survive. Athletes who are strong enough to get to the World Championships and try to make a final or show up to the Olympic trials this year and once again try to steal a spot on Team USA. In order to be the best, you're gonna have to beat the best. And the University of Florida got almost all of the best athletes to show up on one track in a meet that wasn't even scored. Just remember, if you are not in the front of the race, in the fastest heat, you are now the rest of the guys. SCA track and field gear is here. Fast is a lifestyle, and what you wear should reflect that. Order yours at scarecruiting.com/shop or use the link in the description below. It's a huge support to me and this channel so I can continue to make you more content like this. And remember, it is always greatly appreciated if you would please like and subscribe.